Well, when I got to IUPUI in 1989, we had an opportunity to take over management, my center did, to take over management of a dying GIS laboratory. And I was happy to do that because I could see many uses for it in the kind of work that we did, which was had nothing to do with history or the humanities. But since I'm a historian, I got to wondering, well, what does this tool called GIS have to offer for us in the humanities? And began to toy around with that a bit and found out that there was actually most of the work that we did could be characterized as spatial. We just didn't do it very well. We just didn't characterize it that way. Didn't know how to ask spatial questions very well, and didn't know how to do spatial thinking. But the more I was around it, the more I began to understand, I thought, what some of the potential was. And so with my center, we began to do some work and connected pretty quickly to some folks out at University of California at Berkeley that were starting what was then called an Electronic Cultural Atlas Initiative that soon burgeoned to involve about 800 universities worldwide and about 2,000 scholars, all of who were interested in applying this. And from there, we made both the connections and developed the knowledge base that we needed to think more creatively, I think, about how these tools could be applied to the humanities.
Well, you know, we are always asking questions about context. It's really important to know the context out of which events occur. But what's really striking is that most historians don't include the geography of where the thing occurred or the event occurred or where the actions occurred or where the thought originated. Or if they do, they treat it strictly as backdrop. And yet, in fact, we know from our everyday experience how much place shapes us, just as we shape place in turn. So the real issues, I think, with the spatial history and the spatial humanities is how do you understand those places in their fullest dimension, not just simply as an agglomeration of people who interact with each other in some particular way, but who are influenced and influence in turn the geographical environment in which they find themselves. I mean, after all, there is, we know that weather influences us in particular ways. Those of us who are from the South are very familiar with that, just as those, I suspect, from Maine are equally familiar in quite different ways. So we can just extend that and understand that if you're from a hill country, you have a different perception of the world than if you're from flatlands. That if you're from a place that is isolated, you have a different understanding of distance than if you're from an urban area. That shapes you as an individual, so just by extension, we can understand how this might shape us historically in ways that are important for us to understand. Yeah, boy, I tell you, when we first started to try to apply, we came to understand very quickly that if it wasn't a point line or polygon, you couldn't do very much with it. And of course, much of the evidence we work with is textual. It's imaged evidence, and it doesn't quite conform to the very strict demands of a geographic information system, certainly as those information systems were built in their earliest days. And so we had to grapple with how it is that you deal with such issues as uncertainty or ambiguity. How do you deal with something where it's not quite clear what the spatial footprint of this event might be? What was striking to me, though, is we do this all the time when we're talking about time. We often sometimes are not at all clear about when something occurred, and sometimes we assign date ranges, and that doesn't bother us at all. But for whatever reason, and certainly when dealing with the technology, it was a big problem. So one of the issues that I've been working on for the last 10 or so years is how it is that we, at first I thought, how could we force the technology to do what it was we wanted it to do? Now I'm thinking is, how can we use the technology for what it can do well and add to it? How can we augment the technology so that we're able to do those sorts of things and ask those sorts of questions that we as historians and we as humanists find interesting and compelling? Well, the one that I'm working on, and I actually think it's going to be the future of GIS and geospatial tools for the humanities has to do with what I'm calling deep mapping. Deep mapping is how we go beyond the map itself, or how we go into the map in a certain way. The map is a representation oftentimes. It's a reflection of our thought process and of our way in which we want to conceptualize the world. But we understand that in doing that, we've done essentially what it is that we do in a book. That is, we've taken a lot of evidence, we've distilled it down, and we've presented it as an argument, although in this instance in a mapped form. But we recognize that in doing that, we've shut off a lot of the contingencies. We've made our choices, and we have hidden or managed not to deal with the contingencies that were present within that environment. We've kind of ignored or brushed over the ambiguities and the uncertainties that existed. And so how is it that we create an environment in which people can do, first of all, can see those things? They can see that within any situation that there are multiple actors, each of whom will have their own view. So how can we position ourselves within this map so that we can see all of those views, so that as we shift position, we can see the different perspective that is there? And that's difficult in a 2D environment. Mm-hmm. That's difficult even in a 2.5D environment. So how do we manage to put ourselves then in something that more approximates the world as we understand it to be? The other issues, I think, have to do with how do we understand that there's a range of evidence out there that we have, that we, in fact, to construct our argument, select, and we organize and we order that. And in a book, that's pretty clear what you're doing. You're organizing that in support of an argument, but it's a fairly linear process. And so this means that the only way that we can deal with things is sequentially. Whereas, in fact, in the world as it exists, we know that many things are simultaneous. So how do we evoke that simultaneity? How do we allow the people who we want to interact with that map, or how do we allow ourselves to use that map to discover things, to recognize that the argument that we might think exists from one perspective doesn't exist from another? Can we find ways to kind of chart our way through this evidence that constitutes what is hidden within that map, so that we can show ourselves and others what paths we have taken? Maybe that we can begin to invite others to take other paths, so that we can constitute this map as an environment where of exploration and discovery and collaboration. Well, a deep map is designed to do that. It tries to put you in an immersive space. I think the way that's going to happen, actually, is through using serious gaming engines, where you begin to populate the environment with the kind of evidence that you have uncovered, but you're in the middle of that evidence. Some good examples exist of, I think, of what's potential. There's the Digital Roman Forum that Bernie Frischer has done. Bernie's now at IU, and I'm delighted to know that, and hope to be working with him in the near future. But in that, you can take the Roman Forum as it exists today, which is a series of stones and artifacts and other things, and you can position below that, the present-day forum, you can position below that the forum as you reconstruct it with digital tools within this 3D and spatial environment. And you can begin to understand as you move through the real forum, you can move through the virtual forum. And you can see how the virtual forum, with its mass and form, gives you a different feel than this forum does, where all you have are the stones and the foundations and perhaps a column or two. You begin to get a sense of space in a quite different way. Some folks at UCLA have actually begun to work with those digital reconstructions of this space to test and to think about what did the funeral oration mean, which was for state occasion. This was a big state occasion, of course, for important people, and they were always delivered in the forum. And so you can begin to ask yourself, now that you have an understanding of the space, well, how far could that sound be heard? You can use acoustics, the acoustical physics, to discover that. And you begin to think then about class arrangements, because you understood that the people who needed to hear that were not going to be the hoi polloi, they were going to be the important people, and they would not be here. So all of a sudden we have it's not something that we could not have discovered through extensive research, but we couldn't feel it. We couldn't experience it in quite the same way as we do by putting ourselves in that environment and recapitulating in some sense. I think the danger is going to be, though, that we don't want this to be strictly a recapitulation, because ultimately, as historians, we're driving toward argument, we're driving toward interpretation. And it's ultimately the meaning of all of this. And so ultimately, digital history and the digital humanities have to be a tool that helps us to get there in a fuller and more engaging and comprehensive way than we're capable of doing simply by the solitary scholar going through the text in the archive and then reporting what he or she has learned. Mm-hmm. I actually think it's going to revolutionize scholarship, mainly because I think we are, although I think it may be some time in coming, mainly because we are a spatially aware world in ways that we never have been, or at least we haven't been certainly in my lifetime, and I'm not sure in the lifetime of those two or three generations of historians and scholars who preceded me and you. Distances have collapsed in a way, and yet we understand that localism is still strong throughout the world. So these two things which oftentimes are seen as existing in tension, in many ways are simply reflections of the spatial dimensions of our world. And I think we're becoming aware of that. And part of the reason we're becoming aware of that is so many of the devices on which we use in our everyday life make active use of location. And we are alert to the fact that we are moving through a world, a physical world. And while we as scholars, I think, oftentimes are, and I am, attracted by ideas and the implications of ideas, we're constantly reminded in our everyday lives that we're inhabitants of a geographical space, and that space is shaping us just as we're shaping it. So I think this and the fact that regardless of whether we have embraced it or not, we are all postmodernist. And in postmodernism, it is emotion and experience that count as much as logic and rationality. It's the recognition that we are more than simply the product of a structured argument. And so all of this, I think, suggests, at least to me, that our disciplines are going to open themselves at some point to the implications of this for the questions that we ask. And in fact, we're going to be asking new questions because of this. And the nice thing is that for reasons not of our own making, but for reasons that are fortuitous for us, we now have tools that we can use, and increasingly we're having those tools that are accessible to us in ways that I could not have imagined 10 years ago. GIS is much easier to use than it was then, but it's going to be even much easier to use in the future. So that all of these things, including the mapping tools that we have, make us continually aware of a space in ways that I think haven't been present in the past. Now the danger, of course, is that these make space so particular for us that we forget the larger context, we forget the scales of space, just like we oftentimes forget scale or time, that things are happening at multiple scales all the time, and what the connection is between these scales is going to be one of the most intriguing questions, I think, that we'll face.
Well, I think the biggest obstacles still are intellectual obstacles. That is, how do you think spatially? How do you think visually? In both of those things, we as historians are not well trained. It's not that we don't have active imaginations. We do. In fact, I suspect most of us, and maybe this is just a human characteristic, most of us, when hearing words or translating those into word pictures in our mind, but we don't know how to ask a question that requires us to think about the meaning of that picture or of that image, and we don't ask the questions that require us to think about the meaning of space. And one of the ways in which I think that's going to be overcome, in fact, you see evidence of it all the time, is an increasing interdisciplinarity, which is itself part of a postmodern scholarship. The difficulty administratively within our university environments is that we're still organized departmentally.
And so the structures that we operate with really push us, they continue to keep us fractured and fragmented in a time when the world in which we live, the economy in which we live, the societies in which we live are increasingly interconnected. So I think the real, one of the administrative challenges, and it has to be true for those of us who have made our lives in the university, is how do we create structures within our institutions that allow for the fluid movement, not just of ideas, but of people, the kind of reconstitution of our disciplines. And maybe the simplest way to think about that is to think about what I think is a real requirement for anybody who wants to embrace the digital world, and that is that it requires collaboration. It requires a team. It means that I've got to know enough about informatics and computer science to be able to communicate effectively, or I have to have a translator who can translate in both directions effectively. Well, already we're talking about 2, 3, or 4 people. We're talking about an environment. So how does that work when your reward structures are based in your departments and your disciplines?